Welcome. We'll start with the 9th chapter for class 8 history that talks about women, caste and reforms. Now, two things before we start this lecture. First of all, the handouts are available under the study material section with the NCERT lectures heading. For history, it's in the history folder. So, for geography, it would be in geography and so on. Again, for those in Hindi, we have the lectures at a separate channel, that's Examrace Hindi. Now, coming on to the topic for today, there were two major social evils that were prevalent during that time. One was against women, and another was for the caste system that existed. So the caste system was divided into Brahmin, Kshatriya, Vaishya and Shudra. Or Shudra or Dalits were considered or were the most were the class on which most of the atrocities were done. Again, when it comes to women, there were numerous practices like early child marriage. Then you had Sati practice that was there, where the widow was burnt alive with the funeral of the husband. You had polygyny that existed, where males were allowed to keep more than one wife, both in Hindus and Muslims. So all those were the kind of social evils that existed into the society, and these needed change. Now this change can come into two forms. One is a sudden change, which is a revolution, or other is a gradual change, which is a reform. However, when we talk about independence, we talk about the people who brought out revolutionary activities. But whenever there is a change that requires a change in the social setup, that change is very gradual or slow, and therefore we call that change as a reform. The leaders who brought out these reforms were known as the social reformers or the crusaders or the meliorist. So those are the common words that are used for the social reformers. Now, as we talked about the state that was there prior to the independence, so even if there was a Dalit child working or going to the school, he was asked to sit outside the classroom. He was not allowed to play into the common area with the friends. Then he was not allowed to drink water from the common tank. So those were the kind of issues that the society had to address during that time. Considering this in view, there were numerous reforms that took place. Now, these reforms were dispersed throughout the country. So, let's have a quick look as to which reforms started in which part of the nation. So, you had the region of Bengal that witnessed Brahma Samaj. Brahma Samaj was started by Raja Ram Mohan Roy, and he is considered as one of the major reformers in India. He was the one who abolished Sati, and after that Sati was banned in 1829. Again, another important reforms that originated from Bengal were the reforms led by Ishwar Chandra Vidyasagar. He worked around the issue of widow remarriage. There was Ramakrishna Mission that was established. The followers of the Ramakrishna Mission were Swami Vivekananda and later on Narendranath. So these two were the followers of Ramakrishna Mission. That was the scenario in Bengal. Coming on to the region of Punjab, you had Arya Samaj that was established by Swami Dayanand Saraswati. Now the views of Swami Dayanand Saraswati and Raja Ram Mohan Roy were similar in the aspect both of those were working for social reforms. Still, there were some differences that existed. So Raja Ram Mohan Roy believed in Vedas, Upanishad, Purans. However, Dayanand Saraswati or Arya Samaj strictly followed Vedas, and he said, gave the slogan, return to Vedas. So that was one thing that was important here, one of the difference. The other important difference was Raja Ram Mohan Roy believed in Islam, Christianity and Hinduism should coexist. However, Dayanand Saraswati worked around the superiority of Hinduism during that time. However, they brought around numerous reforms, mainly for girl education. Numerous schools were established, which are now known as the DAV chain of schools. So that was the scenario in Punjab. From Punjab, there was a sect that moved to Bombay in the name of Bombay Arya Samaj that was established under Satyarth Prakash. And in Maharashtra itself, you had numerous other movements that started, some of which are Prarthana Samaj that was established. Then you have the movements of Jyotirao Phule that were there. Similarly, in the region of Tamil Nadu, you had Theosophical Society that was established. Theosophical Society was later on worked around by Annie Besant. She founded the Central Hindu University in Varanasi, which was later known as the Banaras Hindu University, the BHU. Again, in South, you had Ramaswamy Nayakar, who was also known as Periyar, who worked for the upliftment of the caste system, and he started a new movement, which was the self-respect movement. So these were the major hubs of social reforms during that time. As you can see, most of the reforms worked around women upliftment, women education, girl education, widow remarriage, abolition of Sati. So those were some of the common focus areas. Then for Ramaswamy Nayakar, for numerous people from lower caste and middle class, you had the movement that started against the caste system. Besides these movements, there were other movements that existed. For example, there were numerous Muslim movements that came into being. Some of those were the Wahhabi movement, the Farazis movement. You had the Deoband movement, the Aligarh movement. Under the Aligarh movement, you had the Mohammedan Anglo-Oriental movement that started. And you had Aligarh Muslim University that was established, where education was mixed with Western sciences. So now coming on to the changes that were brought about for the women. About Raja Ram Mohan Roy, we already said how he worked for the abolition of Sati. And Sati was banned later on. Ishwar Chandra Vidyasagar, as we said, he was against the issues of widows, and he worked around the issue of widow remarriage. Similarly, you have Panthalu in South, in Telugu, who worked around the issues of widow remarriage. Dayanand Saraswati, we already talked about. We have Jyotirao Phule. As we said, he worked in Maharashtra. He was working for the ideas of girl education along with the upliftment of the lower caste. So he worked around the caste systems that exist, and he wrote an interesting book which was known as Gulamgiri. And in his book in Gulamgiri, which is very interesting, he compared the blacks in America to the Shudra in India, and he said that how blacks are treated under slavery, similar is the state of Shudra in India. Therefore, we need to uplift the Shudra, and we need to bring a reform movement or anti-Shudra movement, we can say, in the South India. Later on, his ideas were propagated by Dr. B.R. Ambedkar and Ramaswamy Nayakar in South India. So, however, that was the scenario that was brought about by the major social reformers. Women also were part of this reform, and some of the women who ultimately got literate worked for the upliftment of women education or women upliftment. Good examples are Begum of Bhopal. She promoted the education and education of girls. So she opened a school in Aligarh. Begum Roika Shakawat Hussain. She opened school for Muslim girls in Patna and Calcutta. Tarabai Shinde, she wrote a book, Stri Purush Tulna, which was a comparative study of men and women, and she was of a critical idea of the social differences that existed between the men and women during that time. Pandita Ramabai, she was a great well-versed Sanskrit scholar. She worked for the state of women even in the upper Hindu caste, and she said or provided shelter homes to women. For those women who were being working around the evils being faced by the husband's relatives. So those were the things that were happening, or those were the initiatives taken by the females. Then again you had the Child Marriage Act that was passed in 1929, which increased the age of marriage to 16 years for girls and 18 years for boys. Later on it was further revised for 18 years for girls and 21 years for boys. Coming on to the various caste reforms, as we said, Raja Ram Mohan Roy was one of the major leaders. Then you had various Christian missionaries who were working during that time for creating schools for tribal groups, for lower caste and so on. However, many of the lower caste were moving to the cities for small order jobs, and some of them even moved to plantations outside India. However, there were some castes who were at the worst of end. Good examples here would be Mahar caste. Now, Dr. B.R. Ambedkar himself belonged to a Mahar caste, and Mahar got job in the Mahar regiment in army. However, they were considered as untouchable so far. Then you have Dublas in Gujarat. They worked as laborers in the fields of upper caste. Again, you have Madigas in Andhra Pradesh. Now, these were working in the tanning industry or cleaning of the hides, and they were considered as untouchables. Their importance increased during the period of First World War, when the demand for the leather actually increased and they earned huge profit. Afterwards, they were working for their reform movement and their upliftment. So there were numerous scholars who worked around. First of them was Ghasidas. He himself belonged to one of the leather workers and he worked forward for the upliftment of the social improvement, and he started the Satnami movement. The next was Haridas Thakur. He belonged to the Mathua sect and he questioned or argued against the Brahminical text. You had Narayan Guru from Izewa caste in Kerala. He worked for the social upliftment. He gave a quote that was one caste, one religion and one God for the humankind or the mankind. So he worked around the sense of self-esteem for each and every individual. Finally, Dr. B.R. Ambedkar, as we said, he belonged to the Mahar caste. He was taught in an army school. He faced the numerous prejudices during his childhood, where he was not allowed to mix with the children, so on and so forth. Later on, he went for a fellowship in America. When he returned from America, he started a movement against the upper caste. The first movement that he started was the temple entry movement. Under this movement, he said that Dalits should be allowed to enter the temple. They should be allowed to take water from the common tanks, and within a period of 4 to 5 years, he worked around nearly 3 to 4 temple entry movements. Then there were numerous non-Brahmins who were working for the same. So you had Ramaswami Naikar, who was also known as Periyar. As we said, he started the self-respect movement. He said that each and every member has the right or the dignity in himself and he should not be treated in a different way. So the lower caste and the upper caste should be treated at par. That was his basic idea. He was against the orthodox Hindu religion and the Hindu systems that were prevalent during that time. Now, coming on to the state of blacks. So from Africa, you had blacks that were moving to America. And in America, you had the American Revolution, where the liberation of the blacks was talked about. Again, Abraham Lincoln was one of the major leaders who fought against slavery. And he said that that would be the root cause of the good democracy if we want to establish. Now, Brahma Samaj, some of the major organizations that we would discuss. Brahma Samaj, we already talked about how it varied from Arya Samaj. And some of the important leaders included Devendranath Tagore. Then you have Keshav Chandra Sen. And indeed Raja Ram Mohan Roy. So they believed in Upanishads, Vedas. However, Arya Samaj strictly believed in Vedas and they said return to Vedas. Similar to that, in Bengal you had Young Bengal movement under De Rosio. He basically attacked the various customs that were prevalent during that time and talked about women education. Ramakrishna Mission, we already talked about how Swami Vivekananda worked around it, and Swami Vivekananda's guru was Ramakrishna Paramhans, under whose name Ramakrishna Mission has been established. So they talked about selfless service. Prarthana Samaj, again in Maharashtra, we talked about, worked on caste system against child marriage. Ved Samaj is important. This was inspired from Brahma Samaj in Bengal and started in Madras area. It promoted widow remarriage and the idea of one God. It was also against any kind of superstitions that existed. Aligarh movement we already talked about. Singh Sabha reform was important because it worked around organization of Sikhs. It talked about ruling all kind of superstitions from the Sikhism that existed and established the Khalsa College in Amritsar for higher education, which talked about modern teaching along with Sikh teaching. Besides these reformers, there is a list of other important reformers like Vinoba Bhave, Baba Amte. Then you have some of the recent ones. So all these are important social reformers that we would be covering in the upcoming lectures, where we'll be talking more about social reforms in India. So with this, we cover the chapter 9 of class 8 history. We'll be covering more lectures. So do subscribe to the channel. Do stay tuned. If you like the channel, definitely leave comments below the video. Have a very good day ahead.